Welcome, everyone, to this third in our legal debate series. Welcome back to those who attended either or both of our first two debates. A defeat back in, I'm just going to go over the results of that quickly. I thought they were fascinating. A defeat back in February of the motion that citizens have the right to be forgotten, and a defeat last month of the motion that a corporate death penalty would stop companies from breaking the law. Our motion tonight, the European Court of Human Rights is undermining democracy, another hotly debated topic, of course, thrust back into the headlines by the recent election result. I'm just going to say a few words and a little bit about the voting as well. As I've mentioned before, we've gone with this debate format because it injects a little bit of fun and indeed a little bit of friction into the proceedings. You get to vote on who you think... You're not allowed to leave yet, Michael. Yeah. You get to vote on who you think has argued their case more convincingly. Just a reminder to cast your pre-debate vote, if you haven't already done so. You can do that via the app. We've got some instructions up on the screen here. Select the event, select main session, starting at 6:30, and cast your vote, or you can text that vote to text debate 3. Debate 3 is where you text it to the number up on that screen. You wait for the text back, a vote A for yes, B for no, C for undecided. It sounds a little bit complicated, but it's worked in the previous two debates. It's not important to the result where I stand on this issue tonight, but do let me very quickly mention the newsworthy context to this debate. As I'm sure you're all well aware, Britain's new government is looking to replace the Human Rights Act with a British Bill of Rights, thereby breaking the formal link between the country's courts and the European Court of Human Rights. The Tories argue that their Bill of Rights would restore common sense, and this is a quote, common sense to the application of human rights and stop mission creep that has allowed dangerous foreign criminals to use spurious arguments to avoid deportation. That's one of the things we hear a lot about at the moment. Those opposed argue that such changes would weaken protections for the vulnerable, plunge Britain into a constitutional crisis given the ensuing frictions between London and the devolved governments of Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland, and severely damage our reputation internationally. So that is a little bit of the context. Let me introduce our panelists, another group extremely well placed to battle out this motion. Two for, two against. They'll alternate opening statements before we open it up to Q&A for you ahead of the closing statements and your chance to vote again. I'll just go through the speakers and then we'll get going. Arguing for is Kirsty Brimelow, QC from Doughty Street Chambers. We had a colleague of yours, Kirsty, Geoffrey Robertson, at our first debate back in February. I think he lost that one, actually.
He's not mentioned that.
Oh, he has not mentioned that. Kirsty specialises in international human rights law and is president of the Bar Human Rights Committee of England and Wales. I must mention here as well that she is arguing for the motion, not strictly through choice. You might find this a little bit odd, but not strictly through choice, but because we've asked her to. Kirsty would normally sit on the against side, right? But there are parts of this motion that she supports in relation, I believe, I thought, to Article 8, but we'll hear in just a moment. So she's agreed to argue for the motion, so thank you for that, Kirsty. On the same side as Kirsty is Matthew Paris, journalist and former Conservative politician. You'll no doubt be avid readers of Matthew's Weekly Times column. Michael Mansfield, QC, one of the UK's leading defence lawyers, a self-described radical lawyer, is arguing against... self-described radical defence lawyer, it says on his wiki page, I should qualify that. He's participated in many high-profile cases, as you'll all know, including the Bloody Sunday incident, Hillsborough, and the McLibel case. And on the end, the Right Honourable Jack Straw, former Member of Parliament for Blackburn, former Home Secretary, former Secretary, Foreign Secretary, rather, and Secretary of State for Justice. And importantly for this evening, the Minister responsible for incorporating the European Convention on Human Rights into British law back in 1998, right? Let's have a look at the results of the pre-debate vote now. Here you go. So, the fours, i.e. that the ECHR is indeed undermining democracy, 11%. The againsts, i.e. those who disagree, 76%. It's moving as we speak, and the undecideds, 12%. There is a little bit to play for here, actually quite a bit to play for here. As I said, you'll get another chance to vote after we've heard from our speakers. First up, arguing for the motion, Kirsty Brimelow. Kirsty, you've got 8 to 10 minutes. The floor is yours.
Right, now, ignore everything that's just been said in the introduction. We are going to win this debate, and we are going to convince you that, in fact, the motion is one you should be voting for. Now, one of my favourite quotes of Cicero is, "How invincible is justice if it be well spoken." Now, you're going to hear fine words from those urging you to vote against, but I'm not going to romance you this evening. It's not one of those nights, I'm saying to you now, even though you might have had a glass of wine and all feeling slightly fuzzy. It is going to be hard facts that you are dealing with, and that's going to persuade you, using your heads and your intellect, to vote for the motion. Look at the motion. If you substitute lessening power of for undermine, so if you do that, it means the same thing, and think of democracies such as Russia, as well as the UK, and then you really already should be pushing to change your vote. The current Euro hysteria as well is not new, so you shouldn't be moved by that, moved by, no doubt, Jack Straw talking about the Human Rights Act and his part in it, because that is not about party politics. And in fact, the Conservatives were originally drafters as well, which I will come on to. Now, Euro hysteria, Lord Denning, back in 1973, said, "When we come to matters with a European element, the treaty is like an incoming tide. It flows into estuaries and up the rivers. It cannot be held back. Parliament has decreed that the treaty is henceforward to be part of our law. It is equal in force to any statute." So this was just at the time when the UK joined what then was the common market. So the fear of Europe invading everywhere is not something that is new. It goes back over 40 years. But moving on from the economics of things to the legal side, the courts. 2013, at the Conservative Party conference, our then Home Secretary, Theresa May, said something which even the Lord Chief Justice judge professed to be astonished at hearing from a Secretary of State. She said some judges chose to ignore Parliament and go on putting the law on the side of foreign criminals instead of the public. So more hysteria and absolute nonsense. We then had the soulless Chris Grayling, remember him? He was the former Secretary of State for Justice and ironically called the Guardian of the Rule of Law through being the Lord Chancellor. Now, he said that in his launch of this awful British Bill of Rights, terribly drafted, that our courts too now treat the convention and the interpretation of it in Strasbourg as sacrosanct, a near constitutional reference point for what they do, with Parliament having no say. Now, those who have any idea about the Human Rights Act here will know that that is complete garbage. Section 3.1 of the Human Rights Act is clear and unambiguous. The obligation upon the courts is to interpret legislation so far as possible in a way that is compatible with convention rights. It's an alternative to constitutional entrenchment, but it also makes convention rights real. So that's that. Section 2.1a of the Human Rights Act obliges courts only to take account of Strasbourg jurisprudence. Declarations of incompatibility, don't worry about them because they're very rare. So ironically, the only article that brings an obligation upon the state to abide by a judgment of the European Court is actually under the convention itself. Now, that came about in the 1950s, so that's been with us a very long time, and everyone agreed to it. And why did they agree? Well, the history is very important. It was to stop a recurrence of what happened in World War II. It was to stop the murdering, the massacres, the ripping up of people's lives, destruction of property, that had been done by a democratically elected leader, Hitler. So, coming back to the motion, if it was phrased in this way, do those in other institutions outside Parliament, including the European Court and domestic courts, undermine parliamentary power? Your answer is yes. But I'm not going to get away from the motion. Does this mean undermining democracy? Well, what is democracy? Well, Russia's a democracy. And the European Court does undermine democracy, but so it should. So it should undermine democracies like Russia, where they are acting in violation of the rights of their people. Democracy, you don't need to take it from me. Lord Steyn, in a case, Korati, a Mauritius case in the Privy Council, described democracy in this way in 2006. He said the idea of a democracy involves a number of different concepts. The first is that the people must decide who should govern them. Secondly, there's the principle that fundamental rights should be protected. Now, you're going to hear a little more of that from Matthew. And they should be protected by an impartial and independent judiciary. Thirdly, in order to achieve a reconciliation between the inevitable tensions between these ideas, a separation of powers between the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary is necessary. But democracies are not all the same, so don't be fooled by what you're going to hear. The strength of democratic institutions and the configuration of decision making powers varies. There's plenty of authoritarian democracies, and they need to be kept in check. And they're kept in check by the European Court, which lessens their power or undermines them by saying you are acting contrary to these fundamental human rights. Who in this room would not be in favour of the European Court keeping in check or putting a limit on democracies that are abusing their people? I don't think any, so I'm flabbergasted by the vote so far. But let me just flesh it out a little more so you can see what I'm saying. So again, I'm giving you hard facts. If a democratic assembly passes laws in a way that violates fundamental rights, then the courts will step in, or they should step in, if they're doing their jobs properly and they are independent and impartial. If they're not stepping in, then you might have an issue there. And again, the European Court could step in, undermining the democracy, if you put it, as that's part of that definition.
You've got about a minute.
So, a minute. See, that's a complete limitation on my freedom of expression, although it is a qualified right. So I'm going to finish here in my last minute. Human rights comes out of the World War II. The European Convention comes out of the failure of the UN, 50 years on from the UN Universal Declaration. Mary Robinson said that the failure of implementation was on a scale that shames us all. So the European Convention picked up the dropped human rights baton. We then had the Human Rights Act, which was European Convention, which was drafted by conservatives supported by Winston Churchill. We then had the Human Rights Act bringing rights home to the UK, so lots of lawyers didn't have to go off to Strasbourg. And so the motion, and the mischief of this motion, is it's inspired by the tension between judiciary and legislature and the executive, the competing claims there, and this is nothing new. So finally, does this mean that we should then drown in words that you're going to hear, predominantly from politicians, I'm afraid, and some journalists who don't know what they're writing about, none here tonight, who lose faith. Should we then lose faith in democracy and lash out at a so-called foreign court? Or should we not actually be saying we should be proud here, bold and confident to vote yes, we need check with human rights on democracies? And the answer to this, now I'm being finally restricted and cut off, is an obvious, a very obvious yes.
Michael Mansfield, arguing against, is up, yeah. I'm getting confused with all of this now, because Kirsty switched on. Arguing against Michael Mansfield, 8 to 10 minutes starts now.
Right. Well, I wasn't quite sure, don't know about you, about which way Kirsty was blowing in the wind here. Because her true position came out on a number of occasions where she was saying precisely what I want to put to you tonight. I'm addressing the motion. Now, the motion concerns the European Court undermining democracy. And what I want to do is shift the paradigm a bit, because the European Court is not undermining democracy. What it is attempting to do is a very obvious one, and it's had that role from the beginning. And it's a democratic role, that's the point. There is, as it were, a point in time in which the democracies that we have in mind, democracy that we have in mind, has to be underpinned by human rights. And of course, democracy can mean a number of different things, and Adolf had one view, and lots of other people use democracy as a way to get away with murder. I just want to quote something from yesterday. It was a journalist, I'm afraid, that wrote it, but I have great respect for what gets written in the end in the papers, and this wasn't... I want to just pause after I've read it to you to see if you know who actually said all this, because I think the threat to democracy, democracy underpinned with human rights, actually doesn't come from the court. And this is what was written yesterday. Democracy is in crisis. Well, I think it is. Not because of the European Court, but for some of the reasons that are in this quotation. It seems to serve the people no longer, but rather vested interests. And it goes on. The more money you have, the more government pays attention to your concerns. Our democracies are increasingly captured by a ruling class that seeks to perpetuate privilege. Now, it's rather interesting, obviously, to be saying this in the heart of the city. I'm not afraid to say it. I happen to say, and that's not from me, some people out there might think, oh, he made that up. Well, I didn't, actually. It was a quotation from one of Mr. Cameron's closest advisers in the 2010 election. And it provides me with a basis for saying, and in fact we had a discussion before we came in here, that the democratic system that we have is seriously under the microscope at the moment, given the way the votes went and who got represented and who didn't. I don't want to get into whether we have a representational democracy or not, but the threat to democracy, as I say, doesn't come from the court. It comes from lots of other vested interests which at the end of the day govern the way we live our lives. So I leave that to one side and come back to the court. One or two points which I suggest when you're thinking about voting about, and I know Jack will deal perhaps with the origins and the Second World War. This was not the convention itself, wasn't born out of non-democracies. It was born out of democracies saying, not that every democracy will be the same, but that it should have a basic threshold. A threshold which understands common values and principles, which you all adhere to, Kirsty adheres to. It's extremely important that those values are maintained, not in concrete slabs. Some people seem to think that the Human Rights Act well, the convention which led to the Human Rights Act, somehow isn't a living instrument. It is a living instrument. Those who drafted it, including those who were at the time conservative politicians, including Winston Churchill, who obviously had an interest in it, they weren't thinking about setting it in stone so it would never change. They were thinking about some rather, and I brought the convention, and I'm sure those of you are familiar with it. I just want to, if we're going to deal with human rights, you need to know what it is they were saying then and now, and why it matters. For example, Article 3, which is an absolute prohibition on torture. No one shall be subjected to torture or inhuman or degrading treatment or punishment. Now, that is very important. Then it was, and now it is. One of the first cases involved the United Kingdom. It involved the United Kingdom in its performance in Northern Ireland. The use of various techniques, which was white noise, stress conditions, and so on. You see, some of the judges think that this convention was brought into force with the court for the others. But actually, it applies just as much to the United Kingdom as it applies elsewhere. It's not undermining our democracy because a court says you have to abide by certain principles. Now, there's no point in having the convention if you cherry pick. That's an obvious thing. In other words, we say, oh, we don't like that particular ruling, so we won't abide by that, but we'll do this. That's a very fine example, as I'm sure you'll feel, to all those nations who are aspiring to not only join the European Union, but aspire to, in fact, implement the same, as it were, threshold. So you can't cherry pick. It's got to have a binding force on governments. Otherwise, what's the point of having it in the first place? And let me just continue with this, because, of course, bringing it up to date, waterboarding. Oh, yes. That's why I call him Speedy Gonzales, you know, the American Attorney General, who was saying about these provisions, they're all very antiquated. That's the word he used, antiquated. Because why? They wanted to get around it. They're a democracy, or you know that they obviously aspire to be that. And there they are, saying, well, we can get round this, we can call them enemy combatants, and we can do what we like to them. Waterboarding. It's an issue now because there are those out there, believe you me, who will say, in the light of national security and in the light of the threat that's being posed, we should be able to use whatever we wish. Sorry, I disagree. If we're living in a civilized society, we do not need to, as it were, downgrade what we do and become like those who threaten us. So these articles were meant not just to be stagnant in 1950, but also to, as it were, expand and live. And of course, the people who drafted it were Democrats. The judges are elected by Democrats. The Council of Europe and the Parliamentary Assembly is peopled by parliamentarians. 318 of them are in the Parliamentary Assembly at the moment. They're the people who determine the extra protocols. They're the people who ratify this. So we ratify this and then we say the court itself is undermining democracy. It's born out of democracy.
You've got roughly a minute,
Mike. Right. Voting rights. That's the issue that's come up recently, prisoners and voting rights. Now, right at the core of a protocol that is attached to the convention is the fact that voting couldn't be more essential, could it, to democracy than voting. It's Article 3, the right to free elections. What the European Court said, not undermining democracy, it didn't say to the British government, you can't disenfranchise. That's a pretty serious move, as you will agree. What it's saying is a perfectly reasonable, if you like, democratic argument. You don't want a government that's going to legislate for torture, legislate for ankle irons, legislate. No, you don't want a government that goes out that way. You want a government that has regard to specificity, proportionality. And that's all the European Court was saying. You have to consider whether it is right that there's a blanket ban on all prisoners, whatever they're locked up for however long they're locked up, not getting the vote. You are entitled to disenfranchise, but it has to be proportionate. one of the basic principles. And the court itself defers, called the margin of appreciation, defers to national and local courts on issues like this. This is a very important issue because the British government has said, basically, Cameron has said, two fingers. If my government wants nobody to vote once they're locked up, then they won't bloody vote. That's his view.
Must wrap, Michael.
Right, must wrap. Well, I wonder if he would say that about a lot of other things that breach human rights. I feel strongly, that, and I hope you do, that the court is an essential and vital organ. Thank you.
Michael Mansfield, thank you very much indeed. Matthew Paris is arguing for the motion together with Kirsty. Matthew, your 8 to 10 start now.
Well, what a privilege it is to hear one of our top barristers in full flight elevating what to me are tangled and difficult and subtle issues to the clash, the epic clash of high principle. I don't want to be tedious, but if we proposers of the motion want to win on points, we can dispatch the opposition right away. All treaties and conventions undermine democracy. They're supposed to. Membership of NATO undermines democracy. The Treaty of Rome undermines democracy. The rule of law undermines democracy. All constitutions, written or unwritten, undermine democracy. The whole point of binding a nation to something a subsequent government cannot vary or undo is to armour our undertakings against the gusts, otherwise known as popular opinion, to which elected governments are horribly susceptible. Democracy is not an unconditionally good thing. Do we want public lynchings on a daily basis? Do we want flash mobs got up by Twitter storms roaming the streets? Democracy, which is to say what many people think they want at a particular time, is something to be taken account of, something that should be given voice in the way we're governed, and something to be wary of sometimes too. Democracy, like sunshine or rain or physical exercise, is a good thing to be set against and, when appropriate, subordinated to other good things. The framers of this motion have succumbed to the same category mistake as misled the progenitors of the whole misconceived idea of human rights. The attempted elevation of an abstract noun above all possible contradiction by circumstance. It never holds. I don't believe in human rights. I never saw a human right. I don't believe I have the right so much as to the next breath of air that I draw, a proposition to which my maker will one day, and considering my age before too long, add a hearty celestial hear, hear. Havelock Ellis once said the whole religious complexion of the modern world is due to the absence from Jerusalem of a lunatic asylum. I might add that the whole history, the whole industry of human rights can be explained by the absence from the English language of a more commonly understood word for what we have to call desiderata. A human good to be eagerly sought, but not at all costs, is a desideratum, not a right. A fundamental right from which we may derogate as circumstances require is not a fundamental human right. It is a desideratum. But enough jurisprudence. To the motion. What I suppose its framers mean is to ask us whether it's a good thing that the European Convention should trump democracy. Should international law trespass on national opinion? To which I reply, up to a point. The new government, I suppose, want to make a lot of noise and win some fairly cheap applause for what will turn out to be a very slight adjustment to the boundaries of the Convention's trespass upon democracy. This is mildly discreditable. Mr. Mansfield, though he knows it not, and many other eminent persons have been recruited to the government's mildly discreditable purpose in the unwitting role of a wailing Greek chorus at an offstage thunderclap machine to heighten the sense of drama, to flatten ministers with the impression that they're doing something significant, impressing these historic histrionics, impressing upon the more gullible readers of middle-class market tabloid newspapers the notion that a defiant government is cracking down on interfering foreigners. Nothing much is going to happen. This is not, in the end, going to be a big issue. It lacks what we journalists call legs. And shall I tell you how I know? I have reliable means of estimating the shock value of a policy proposal. I read up about it, I make an honest and concerted attempt to understand it, I get the whys and wherefores, the pros and cons all sorted out in my head, and then I go away and do something completely different, make a cup of tea, say, or get out my ladders and prune the wisteria or just get a good night's sleep. Then I come back to it and see if I can remember what it was all about and in 200 words or less explain the issue. If I can't, then I discard it as a story. I have the monstrous vanity to believe that if the arguments haven't lodged properly in my own brain, they won't in other people's either. Appoint yourselves Professor of European Human Rights Studies. Survey the sea of bright young undergraduate faces upturned towards you. This, as follows, is what you need to get into their heads about this debate. We're not talking about the European Court of Justice, think Luxembourg, not for the moment anyway. We're talking about the European Court of Human Rights, think Strasbourg, for the moment anyway. So not for the moment the one that serves the European Union, but the one that serves the Council of Europe. So not the court established in 1952, 1959 is the date we're after. So here we are in Strasbourg, not Luxembourg, in 1959, not 1952, and our court was not founded by the Treaty of Rome, no, but by Article 19 of the ECHR, where the C stands for Convention, whose progeny was the ECHR, whose C stands for Court, the European Court of Human Rights. So keep up. By Article 19, the ECHR spawned the ECHR. Distinguish both from the ECHR, which was the European Commission on Human Rights, abolished in 1998 by Protocol 11, which decided to replace it with the European Commissioner for Human Rights, whose functions were wider. Now, here I must quickly remind you to be aware that the ECHR answer not to the EU, but to the more expansive Council of Europe, their expansiveness surpassed only by the EBU, that is the European Broadcasting Union, which is responsible for the ESC, the Eurovision Song Contest, in which Australia is this year among the favourites to win. What we're talking about then is something that's closely related to, but not the same as the EU, a muddle indicative of the tangle we're trying to unpick. Who governs what? Where do responsibilities lie? What will happen if we take this or that action? What will happen? Generally nothing, obviously, as Russia wouldn't be in it, if we don't take this or that action. Are you clear? The ECHR, governed by the ECHR, different to the former ECHR and incorporating the other ECHR, is separate from the ECJ, a court administered by a different body, the EU. I've just temporarily forgotten how and why the ECJ is distinguished from the ECHR, but I do remember that this isn't what we're talking about. Remember, this isn't about the ECJ, whatever that is. Mainly, we're talking about the Human Rights Act. I am not unusually stupid. I did once obtain a first-class degree in law at Cambridge, but honestly, I'm lost. I knew it earlier this afternoon when my assistant explained it all to me, but by the time I'd mastered it, he'd forgotten it. We only both knew it simultaneously during a brief overlap for 10 minutes from 5 p.m. Then I forgot it too while he went off to reacquaint himself with it.
You've got about a minute.
I glimpse through the glowing fog, two shafts of light. Two beams illuminate our way here, I think, two truths. First, we in the media had better abandon this whole story as mission impossible. And secondly, that the government should and will abolish one acronym and declare victory. Bad countries will carry on disregarding human rights anyway, as they always have, and the Earth will continue in its orbit.
Representing the journalists tonight, Matthew Paris.
Right. Thank you very much indeed, Matthew. Finally, arguing against the motion tonight is Jack Straw. Your 8 to 10 starts now.
Thank you. When the Second World War ended, there is no historical rule guaranteeing that the democratic values of the Allies on the Western Front would become norms of behaviour for states across the continent of Europe. Indeed, the trend of history suggested the opposite. And for all the fine aspirations of the victors at the end of the First World War, The punitive peace terms imposed on the vanquished led in part directly to dictatorship and the Second War. And on top of this, there was the determination of one of the victors against fascism, the Soviet Union, to impose in Eastern Europe not democracy, but a dictatorship of the proletariat. The fact that 70 years on, democracy has not only become the norm across most of Europe, but the universal yardstick against which good governance is measured across the world, has not therefore been accidental, far from it. Many factors have contributed to this outcome, but without doubt, the establishment of the Council of Europe and under its aegis, the Convention, the European Convention on Human Rights, has been of fundamental importance to the achievement of that end. At the heart of the Convention is the understanding that if democracy is seen as being only about the will of the majority, that can and does lead, paradoxically, to the most intensive tyranny. Hitler could plausibly claim to have popular consent for his authoritarian, violent, and genocidal policies. So rather, as the convention correctly spells out, and in contrast to what Matthew was trying to persuade you, a functioning democracy has not only to secure respect and legislative dominance for the majority, but crucially, must also protect the rights of minorities and the rights of individuals, even if those minorities or individuals engage in actions which are themselves violent, depraved, and anti-democratic. And for those involved in the political process of democracy, there has to be a significant degree of self-restraint by those in a majority, self-restraint based in part on self-interest, in the knowledge that you can and will lose power at some stage, and then you'll be across the chamber in the minority. The European Convention is a skillful text. Some rights, as Mike has mentioned, like prohibitions against torture or slavery, are absolute. Most are qualified, seeking, for example, to balance the right to privacy with the rights of a free press. But to come directly to the motion, the convention would have been an empty vessel without a means of enforcement. Hence, the European Court, as Matthew has reminded us, established in 1959, and a court which has become much more active since the collapse of the Berlin Wall and the reality that all 47 states within the Council of Europe at least subscribe, in theory and most in practice, to human rights and are ready to see their governance held to account for their stewardship of those human rights to which they've all signed up. Now, for some decades, we in the United Kingdom basked in the complacent belief that there was no need to allow our domestic courts to adjudicate on human rights, since it was argued the convention itself was no more than a statement of British rights, which were embodied in our culture and in our common law. But that was at a time, and it continued right until the 1980s, when, for example, there was no control whatsoever by Parliament on the activities of our security and intelligence agencies. There was no statutory regulation of the interception of communications, none whatever, and none either regulating the interrogation of suspects by the police. In each of these cases and others, it was decisions by the European Court in Strasbourg which directly or indirectly prompted the British Parliament and government to change our law in ways with which no one would argue today. This has not, however, made the court a perfect institution. Far from it. I've been one of many who in recent years has strongly criticised the Strasbourg's court's ever-widening scope, going beyond any idea that I've had of what is involved in a living law, with its jurisdiction reaching beyond that ever anticipated in its founding treatise. The trigger for my concerns, to which Mike has mentioned, was the court's 2004 decision in the case of Hearst, which asserted that the United Kingdom's ban on the right to vote of convicted and sentenced prisoners, it wasn't a blanket ban, was unlawful. I believed, as I still do, that this question of prisoner votes was outside the remit of the Strasbourg court. It should have been passed straight back to the United Kingdom under that margin of appreciation. For as the Dean of the Law Faculty at Oxford observed, taking away a prisoner's right to vote is no more an abuse of their human rights than taking away their freedom of movement. And nor, for example, is the issue of night flights at Heathrow a matter of basic human rights on which the Strasbourg court has also opined. And the problem with this territorial expansion by the court was that we were faced with the fact that there was no way that that judgment could be enforced. Because even if I'd agreed with the judgment, the British House of Commons on an all-party basis did not. And this is in contrast to the fact that government and parliament here have long accepted that where the Strasbourg court has handed down judgments well within the competences to which we'd all signed up on basic human rights, the prohibition against arbitrary arrest, against torture, against the right to a fair trial, and the deportation of terrorist suspects as well, where there is a real risk that they could be tortured or killed when they arrived at their country of origin, then we should respect the court's decision and, if necessary, amend our own domestic law. But the issue of prisoner votes was different and in many ways became totemic of a kind of unacceptable, as I've described it, territorial extension by the court. And for that reason, I and a number of other senior figures in the Commons took a stand against it. And the problem that with which we were arguing, and we argued with judges in the court in Strasbourg, was that they were trying to set themselves up as a supreme court for Europe, but without the democratic override, which is a feature of all supreme courts in democratic nation states, the USA included. So why am I opposing this motion rather than supporting it?
Yeah. I'm sure I have time to make this point.
First, not least because as a result of the House of Commons digging in on the issue of prisoner votes, the Strasbourg court has now in practice backed off on this and other matters where they were extending their jurisdiction. Aided by the retirement of the previous president of the court, wiser heads in Strasbourg have recognised that their courts needs to stick to its core business of basic human rights, the purpose for which it was established. Second, I oppose the motion because in parallel with the outbreak of common sense in Strasbourg, the higher courts in the United Kingdom have themselves decided to adopt a more sensible approach to Strasbourg decisions. They had for some years decided they should simply follow those decisions, which is not required under the Human Rights Act. Now they're doing what the Act does say to take account of those decisions. But the third reason is that now that Strasbourg is reforming itself, I face a binary choice whether to believe or not that this court is undermining democracy. And I don't believe it. It does need further reform. But overall, I believe that the Council of Europe, the Convention and the court, taken together, have unquestionably been a force for good and almost against the odds have helped nurture and sustain the democratic ideal across most of a continent whose leitmotif in previous times was to prefer the killing fields to the vote. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jack Straw. Thank you to all of our debaters this evening. Right, those were the uninterrupted statements. I want to give you now, the audience, a chance to put a few of your own questions to the panel as you head towards another vote. Let's have some questions. Yeah, gentlemen right here, if you just wait for the microphone and tell us who you are.
Naeem Saeed. I think the point that was made about taking it in total, it's on the whole a good thing, is interesting and probably right. But what I'd be interested to hear from the panel is, one, why is this such a political issue in the UK? If the Conservatives hadn't got back in, this wouldn't be on the agenda now. And why are the right so rabidly against the court, whereas the left don't seem to be? Why is that? I wonder if there's any views on that. And I guess the point that Jack Straw made about the idea that in the main, how do you get the judges to back off, if you like? How can you get them to back off? How can you get them to take notice unless you say something like, I'm going to change the legislation? Because this isn't this a question of the old problem of politicians or the executive branch versus the judiciary? This is an age-old problem, and it's always played out, particularly in the States, where there's almost a sensitive recognition that the judges have to be cognizant of the legislature and the executive.
Okay. Jack Straw, thank you. Why don't you take that one to start? Well,
why has it become a political issue? I mean, it's bound to be in one sense. The Conservatives did, in the end, support the Human Rights Act. They voted against the second reading. I secured amendments to it. They supported the third reading of the Human Rights Act. It had a difficult adolescence, as it were, essentially because of 9/11. Without 9/11 and the very difficult tests with which the whole of the judicial system was faced, in the, I think that it would now be accepted on an all-party basis. Matthew referred to the concerns, some might say hysteria, of some of the newspapers when courts have said that a particular terrorist suspect should not be deported. My answer to that, I mean, to that is you'll always get this, but as Home Secretary, I mean, even absent the Human Rights Act, Strasbourg and anything else, if you're faced with evidence that if you deport a terrorist suspect, there is a risk that they're going to be tortured or killed, then, I mean, it is both an amoral and also a very stupid Home Secretary who goes ahead with the deportation. And in a democratic system, you have to accept that part of the price you pay for democracy and the rule of law is that sometimes guilty people walk through free and unpleasant people stay within our borders. The balance between an independent judiciary and a functioning parliament is a complex one. Ultimately, the parliament must have the final say. But going back to the point I was making earlier, parliament and ministers have to exercise a high degree of restraint, both about in respect of the rights of minorities, but also in respect of institutions like the courts, because they are there quite rightly to hold the executive in check.
All right, thank you. Michael.
Yes, I'd just like to follow that through, because human rights is a political issue. If you read through the convention, you're dealing with political, as it were, aspirations. We're talking about freedom of expression. They're all these are qualified ones. Freedom of expression, association, and so on, which we all talk about, and we all value those things as a value of our democracy. It's not undermining democracy. It's enhancing democracy. So it's a political issue. But I just want to follow through Jack's point, because I was involved in some of these cases internally, and I think it's a very good microcosm against which you can set what the European Court is doing. What was happening within the United Kingdom in what were called the Belmarsh cases was effectively, and I see people nodding, you'll probably remember these cases, it was basically internment in the United Kingdom without trial. Now that is, never mind all the provisions about fair trial, there was no trial. There are all sorts of national security reasons given for that situation. And it took British courts to begin to step in, and that's when the politicians got shirty about the whole matter, because they thought they govern, they have the power, and therefore if they say people can be locked up, they can be. And this is my point. For the British judiciary, as it did then, to stand up to politicians, is that undermining democracy? No. What they were doing is no more than the European Court is doing, is saying, excuse me, those of you who wield power, just remember what the basic values are, and whatever else you do, you cannot drop below the threshold. And that those who are anxious for power, left and right, I don't restrict criticism of the court to the right. There are those on the left who also do. So it's a mistake to categorise it in that way. But I think it's a political issue we have to face.
Okay, thank you, Michael. Hold on one second. Kirsty, did you want to say something about that?
Just very briefly, I think the language of human rights could do with being reclaimed, because it's become quite distorted by being misused. For example, health and safety cases you can see all the time. If someone protests, just a sort of normal person going around protests about something, oh, it's human rights, this is the reason, it's human rights. And it's nothing usually to do with human rights. And so people have become very sick of it. And so because of that, it's become
politicised. So I don't agree it's necessarily, it's always been political. The meaning's been distorted. I work a lot outside the UK in other jurisdictions, and from those looking in, they see human rights back in its pure form as something which is very valuable, the right to life, because they don't have the luxury that happens here of complaining when there is overreaching by the European Court, that they're more fundamentally actually trying to get out of unlawful detention or trying to find the loved ones who've disappeared or find out what's happened to those who've been massacred. So I think that's one reason. It's become an easy political football, and I think that's very sad.
Okay, thank you, Kirsty. We had a question there, and then we'll come to your question. Yeah.
Hi, Peter Hood. Matthew Paris suggested that the European Convention and the European Court were just acronyms, that they didn't really have any practical significance and that we wouldn't really notice if Britain withdrew. I wonder whether the rest of the panel agree with that and whether they think it's conceivable that Britain could withdraw from the European Convention.
Do you want to start with that, Matthew?
Well, I don't think it's conceivable. No, I don't think we would withdraw from the European Convention. There are some people who speak of it. I think it would be a foolish thing to do. It would set a bad example. It would be bad politics. And it wouldn't help our own jurisprudence here in Britain. But we do have a problem with some of the judgments that are reached by the European Court of Human Rights, and I think that governments and politicians, and in his day, Jack Straw, are quite right to stand up to them.
I mean, given the as I mentioned at the top, the constitutional crisis, or the issues that this raises, and it's not the debate tonight, but is this really likely to happen anyway?
Withdrawal from the European Court, though some... The convention, though some speak of it, I think is not likely to happen.
Right.
It's just reasserting, rebalancing our rights against the Supreme Court's rights against the European courts, not the convention.
Yeah, let's have a question over here. Unless anyone else wanted to comment on that. Go ahead.
Yes, I've got a bit confused over your definition of democracy, and it would be entertaining if it weren't so serious, because... You know, in a week's time, there is going to be a proposal to remove the Human Rights Act, and actually the document does say, as a backstop, withdraw from the convention. So I would like to know from each and every member of the panel whether you think the protection of minority rights is an essential characteristic of a democracy.
Jack, well, shall we start with
you? Yes, is the answer, and I disagree with some of the definitions that particularly Matthew was coming up with. If you don't protect minority rights, it's not a democracy. It's a mob rule, a tyranny of the majority.
Michael?
I agree with that. And I just wanted to really quote the figures, because you need to see, if you're talking about the United Kingdom and this whole debate about withdrawal and so on, that the court and the convention is a threat. Well, I've got the figures for 2012. Vis-a-vis the United Kingdom, there were 2,082 applications to the court vis-a-vis the United Kingdom. 98.3% were ruled inadmissible. 23 cases, 1.1%, there was no violation of any human rights. And the smallest percent, 0.6%, UK was held to be in violation. Mm-hmm. Let's keep a sense of proportion, another principle of the convention. So it seems to me you have to bear that in mind. And I'm absolutely certain that in order to... They can't withdraw just like that because, and Cameron knows this, and certain journalists have been pointing it out, you've got Scotland incorporating the Human Rights Act and the convention, particularly the convention, the Welsh Assembly, and in Northern Ireland and the peace process. Now, they're not having the same complaints about it. So Cameron's got a big job. He knows he's got a big job on his hand with Scotland anyway, in other regards. It's a non-starter.
Let's get your views on the question over here, minority rights.
Well, the lady referred to a document. You're quite right. There was a document, a proposal. It was not repeated, not echoed in the Conservative manifesto. I have no doubt the Conservative Party has gone soft on any idea of withdrawing from the European Convention, and not to follow in Paddy Ashdown's footsteps, I would eat my hat if the government actually withdraws the United Kingdom from the European
convention on democracy. Democracy is government by the people. Democracy is doing what the people want. And it's not for us, it's not for Mike Mansfield, it's not for Jack Straw to say which of those things that the people may want don't count as democracy. Democracy is what the people want. And it's therefore important that we have treaties, conventions, constitutions to guard against giving the people what they want all the time at any point.
Or Steve Hilton, for that matter.
Yes.
Can I just come on to that? I think what you're referring to there is, in fact, I said what Chris Grayling said at the big press launch of this last year, and all of it was completely wrong. And so that was corrected in the press and at various public events, and it's now been buried, thankfully. So I agree with Matthew on that. I mean, he got it completely wrong, and nobody's actually seen this Bill of Rights that's been drafted, and nobody can find any lawyer to admit to having drafted it. So it was still looking. So the whole thing was really, it became, I don't agree it was serious at all. It started off serious, it became a farce. But in terms of minority rights, I would actually rather, I think that's open to interpretation as well, in terms, I'd rather use marginalised, people who are marginalised. But of course, they need protecting. The fundamental point here, though, is everyone has a blind trust in democracies. And those of us who've worked in so-called democracies know that you need them to be undermined. So that's why I'm on this side of the motion saying you need something like the European Court to come in to undermine, to say, look, you are no longer protecting the rights of your citizens and the rights of those minorities that you're concerned about.
Okay, thank you, Kirsty. Yeah, was there a question in the middle here? If not, we'll come right here. Yeah, and then we'll come over to you.
I was very interested to follow Kirsty's take in this whole thing, that we need to undermine democracy. And I was somewhat surprised, but I think it's relevant. And I wonder, and my question is, although it should come with a comment, my question is whether the whole debate is wrong to phrase it around democracy. Perhaps we should be talking about liberalism and liberties. Yeah. Because as was said, as Patrick, Matthew said, democracy, and if I can bring the Greek definition in this, is the kratos, the rule of the people, of the demos, demokratia, right? But that's not enough. Greek democracy, which was a direct democracy, Athenian democracy, was not liberal.
Okay. Is it?
So the question is about human rights. And in fact, elsewhere, they're not known as human rights. They are known as the rights of the individual. Atomika dikiomata, the rights of the individual. One individual can be as powerful as any majority and resist that majority.
Is it the wrong word, Matthew?
Is democracy the wrong word? Well, no, I mean, democracy is one thing, human rights are another thing, and democracy can be antipathetic to human rights.
Can I pick up both of you, because I think there's something profoundly elitist about Kirsty's definition of democracy, which is assumes that there is some kind of group of people who are above the majority, who enforce their will by some means or another to prevent mass rule. I don't define it in that way at all, Kirsty. I mean, how I define it, let me use the example of Nigeria, where against all the odds, there has been just recently a peaceful transfer of power, for the first time ever, from one party, a presidential candidate, to another. What happened there? I know the country a bit, and I simplify, but after a long period of turbulence, the mass of the people on both sides of the political divide have worked out that it's in their interests to start respecting the rights of minorities, of the people who lose as well as the people who win, because the people who win won't win forever. And so you've got a much more textured idea of democracy, which in my view has to include human rights or it is nothing.
Can I come back on Nigeria? Yep. I'm very pleased because I've worked there a lot. Nigeria is a typical democracy which was at one point being ruled by all intents and purposes by the army under Goodluck Jonathan. So there you are, an elected people. So what I'm not saying this is a sort of weird little secret bunch of people at the top. What I'm saying is, you have people going to the ballot box, such as in Venezuela, Nigeria is another example, Zimbabwe is another example, and they are the elections are free and fair, they're monitored, so they pass all of that, and then you get violations of fundamental rights which need protecting. Now, that's a functioning democracy. However, you need some interference by the treaties in order to stop the type of destruction that happened under the democratically elected leader, Hitler. So that is why you need undermining of democracy. So placing faith in your elected representative, which is what you do, Jack. So once you're all there, everything is fine. I'm afraid history shows it doesn't work like that.
Okay, Michael.
Yeah, I think it's almost a casuistic distinction, this, between democracy and human rights. They're not two separate things. And whilst that tension goes on and you have this black and white situation, then of course you get led into some kind of political quagmire. What was happening after the Second World War and is still happening in the Parliamentary Assembly connected to the Council of Europe is a need to ensure that there are democratic values. Now, we may not, they were all agreed as values. Democratic values. That's how they're described in the convention. I don't want to read them all out again, but you know the ones I'm talking about. Besides, right to life is an obvious one, and the torture is an obvious one. But as you work down, you get into assembly and association and freedom of speech. These are basic values. They've all got provisos, but in the same protocol that deals with free elections, that's pretty important. Isn't it, as a quality of democracy? This isn't about allowing people to, as it were, mob rule. It's about informing democracy, informing the demos about what the standards ought to be so you get an educated, informed public, not mob rule. And in the same, sorry, one yep, more point. In the same protocol as the right to free elections is the right to education. Now, it's easily said, but it has to be spelt out. Because, as a previous Labour person once said, education, education, education.
All right. Was there one? Yeah. Let's have one final quick question here, and then we'll get our summing up statements. Go ahead. No, we can't hear you. Do you want to
speak a bit louder?
Yeah. Perfect.
Is it not right that Parliament should legislate to get rid of any ambiguities and interpretations? And the inequalities which Michael Mansfield and Jack Straws talked about, because ultimately Parliament is the democratically elected government of this country.
Okay.
Yes.
Matthew, why don't you start with?
Yes, I agree entirely with that. The Conservative Party, and I am a Conservative, has only itself to blame for the language it's used. It said we're going to scrap the Human Rights Act. Scrap is the word they keep using. It's for the Daily Mail. And they will scrap the Human Rights Act, but they'll then replace it with another Human Rights Act, which is slightly different and gives a little more weight to decisions taken here by the Supreme Court and a little less weight to decisions taken on the other side of the channel. And that is all that's going to happen.
Anyone else on this? And the content of the Bill of Rights and Responsibilities?
Well, I mean, I looked at whether, when I was Justice Secretary, whether we could have a separate British Bill of Rights and Responsibilities. You can have one, but it will be remarkably similar to the European Convention, as long as we stay within the Convention. And lady over there asked whether I anticipated that UK would withdraw. Matthew's given the answer. It remains open to any British government and Parliament to denounce the treaty establishing the Council of Europe. We can withdraw. We have denounced treaties in the past. That is a democratic right. The thing is, it will have consequences. And happily, wiser heads in the Conservative Party have understood that if we pull out of the Council of Europe, it will significantly reduce and undermine our influence with nation states who are not properly democratic, who would love us to do something which appeared to be undemocratic.
Okay. Thank you,
Jack. We also wouldn't need a referendum on the EU.
Well, I mean, this is one thing we have to talk about, how much this has got to do with Brexit, right? Yeah. Well, we're not going to go there tonight.
No.
That's for another day.
Yeah.
Michael.
Just on the point about Parliament passing a Human Rights Act, as Jack has already said, it's going to emulate the convention in any event. There's no way round most of the way they've spent blood and tears to get to where they got. But they drafted it in such a way that they don't have to define every single right. To give you an example, I mean, you wouldn't have expected those who drafted, and I wouldn't expect somebody drafting the Human Rights Act, when it comes to fair trial, to map out all the precise elements of a fair trial. That would be another whole statute, of course, and there is one. So you don't put it in there, and that one of the ones that has influenced the whole of Europe came from the United Kingdom, and that is, and it may not mean very much when I just spell it out, but it's an extremely important right, and that is access to a lawyer at the point you are first interviewed by the police or the agents of the state, whoever they happen to be. Now, you don't put that in the bill or the Human Rights Act. It's subject to interpretation. Somebody's going to have to say, is that consistent with a right to a fair trial? And that's where you do get tensions, but that's where courts come in.
Yeah. Okay, Michael, thank you very much indeed. Right, we're going to go to our closing statements now. Right after this, do start voting again straight away, because we're not going to have too much time. I'm going to ask you all to try and squeeze this into 60 seconds to 90 seconds. I said 2 minutes at the start, but 60 seconds to 90 seconds would be good. Same order as before. Kirsty, go ahead.
Well, I'm afraid neither Mike or Jack has actually addressed the issue of what a democracy is. And they have brushed over the issue of authoritarian democracies. They haven't touched upon them. Now, the point that is a valid point that Mike makes is that, well, rights are meant to be within the democracy itself. To be more precise with that, that is meant to be the fundamental rights, the absolute rights, and there's plenty of definition in relation to that. Now, Lord Sumption, in a lecture fairly recently, so one of our Supreme Court judges, said that Article 8, so this is the right to privacy, family life, has been extended from its original intention in the convention, which was to protect against state surveillance, and it was very clear, and there's been case law since then, it's very clear that was its purpose. It's been extended to cover the legal status of illegitimate children, immigration and deportation, extradition, aspects of criminal sentencing, abortion, homosexuality, assisted suicide, child abduction, the law of landlord and tenant, and a great deal else besides. So that is the problem. Mm-hmm. Now, we've already shown you that there has been, you have to have undermining of democracy, even on fundamental rights, right to life, torture, and so on. But this shows that where you have those coming in, and Jack Straw's already accepted this, this is a so-called mission creep, and that should be left for debate amongst Parliament.
All right, Kirsty, thank you very much indeed. Michael.
Yes, well, we have on this side defined democracy. So I completely deny what has just been suggested that we haven't done. We've done that, and please be listening to what we've tried to say. Jack has called it textured. I'm calling it an inherent part of the democracy that we not only fought for, but actually we attempted to establish in the 1950s with the court. In other words, there are basic values, democratic values, that we want to ensure continue here as well as elsewhere. And unlike Sumption and some of the other lords who seem to be suggesting, you know, these rights are all very well for everybody else and we need to be looking at everybody else, we need to be looking in our own backyard at the same time. So we are talking about a democracy that is enhanced by the European Court. It's not undermining it, it's making it of better value. That's what we stand for.
Thank you, Michael. Matthew.
Democracy means the will of the people. The people sometimes get it wrong, the people get excited, the people get overheated. We need institutions, we need conventions to give a little stability to the whole thing, sometimes to give pause to thought. We have the European Convention on Human Rights. It's an excellent thing. Britain was involved in its establishment. We must maintain it. We must respect it. The only question is who interprets it. At the moment, our Supreme Court interprets it and the European Court of Human Rights interpret it. The present government plan to give a little more weight to our Supreme Court and a little less weight to the European Court of Human Rights. I think that's a sensible thing, but it's no big thing.
Thank you, Matthew. And to finish up with Jack Straw.
Yeah. There are plenty of criticisms that one can make of the European Court in Strasbourg, and I've made some of them. But the question before this chamber here tonight is whether the European Court has or has not undermined our democracy. And the way I ask you to think about it as you come to vote is your life, is our life, better or worse for the fact that the European Court in Strasbourg exists and we have mechanisms for enforcing its judgment? I believe that it's made the quality of our lives, of our society, of how we treat our neighbours, better. It's improved the functioning of our democracy. And for those reasons, this motion ought to be defeated. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Right, start voting, please, now, because we haven't got much time. It was pretty obvious, actually, which way you felt about it beforehand. Few fours, quite a few against, and about 11% of you were undecided, I believe. While you're voting, and before we head out and grab a drink and something else to eat, I did want to mention that we've got one final debate in our series of four, the 30th of June, focusing on the future of law. We'll keep all of you and all of the attendees updated on the whole series via email, so you won't miss out on that. It was another fantastic evening this evening. Let's put up the final scores now. And I've got to say... wow. Extraordinary. I think I'd better stop talking until that has settled. There you go.
It's like an exit poll.
It's like an exit poll.
All right, we've settled at 16%. So you are up a little bit on the agrees. The disagrees, the against, are
at
87. And the undecided, it's okay, we've swayed a few of you, at least the 11%, there's only 1% of you undecided. I can safely say the motion is defeated. Mike Jack, have it. Thank you very much indeed to all of our speakers, Kirsty Brimelow, Matthew Paris, Michael Mansfield, Jack Straw. Thank you very much to all of you for your questions and your voting.